The book of the Revelation. When I think of this book, I think of three things. To me, the book of Revelation is a book of majesty, it's a book of mystery, and it's a book of misery. Because it tells me about the end of time, and it tells me about beyond the end of time. Why not get something inspiring? Why not get out of time into eternity? A preacher came to see me a few days ago. He said, "You talk about the Puritans, you talk about Hawker and Owen, and some of those majestic characters. What's the difference between those men in the 1600s and the men today?" "Oh, that's easy to answer. They lived in eternity, we live in time. We're so earthbound. We're always talking about numbers, the unsaved, the lost never." "That's right. But first of all, if you're going to get inspiration, we've got to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith."
"Yeah."
"And I saw a great white throne and him that sat upon it, from whose face the heavens and the earth fled away." Can you think of anything more awesome than that? "From his face the heavens and the earth fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. The sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. They were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." I sat at my desk and the tears began to pour down my face. You can listen to your TV and radio evangelist for 10 years, you won't hear a sermon on the second death. They hardly dare preach on the first death, never mind the second one.
Yeah.
When did you last hear a sermon on TV about hell? About everlasting destruction? It's not fashionable, it doesn't bring the money in. It doesn't tickle the ears, it tickles the conscience. Luke chapter 16. "There was a certain man which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and he fed sumptuously or extravagantly every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which laid at his gate full of sores." Now notice there are two beggars in this story. One begs in time and the other begs in eternity. The other is begging at the gates, hoping he can get a few crumbs. But you find a little later, in verse 24, that this man cried and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me." He's begging. "Have mercy, have mercy." This shatters forever the idea you can pray to saints. This man prayed at the wrong time to the wrong person for the wrong thing, and he got the wrong answer. "It came to pass the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom," which was the Jewish conception of heaven. "The rich man also died and was buried. In heaven he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and he seeth Abraham afar." You know that thing got hold of me? And it still has hold of me. This man is in torment. You've heard me say more than once, "I'm going to heaven, and I'm not going for the weekend." And some of you are going to hell, and you're not going for the weekend. I didn't have time. I'd like to have had a piece of paper put across here with this printed in big letters on it tonight so you would see it. Hell has no exits. Notice what it says carefully here. "In hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and he seeth." He seeth. You know, people in hell can see. I believe one of the perpetual torments, remember, it's not going to pass in a weekend. I believe everybody goes to hell will see everything that's going on in heaven. He lifted up his eyes, being in torments. So he's very conscious. You know, some people try to say, "Well, there isn't such a thing as hell." A few minutes after the man gets angry, he said, "Go to hell." What's he saying? Go to nowhere? Jesus spoke about hell 10 times. He spoke about heaven only once. I hear people say, you know, one of the signs of the last days is all this heresy. The Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in hell. The Mormons don't believe in hell. Mooneyites don't believe in hell. I've got news for you. You don't believe in hell either. Come on now, here's a man. And all his life he went to church. When they made appeals, he pulled out a checkbook. He's very generous, a soft touch, as you say. He'd give to missions, he'd give to other things. But he died unsaved. He had a fine service. The preacher told lies over him, as they often do when they bury people. And he wakes up in hell, and he looks there into eternity, and there's his precious wife. He's scorned and ridiculed and laughed at. And she's at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and he's going to burn forever and ever. And he's looking back and thinking, how many times I laughed when my wife talked about that. How many times I heard a preacher, I thought it was too far out. I thought it was a kind of a fairy story. Everybody who goes to hell will be able to recite every word of every sermon they ever heard since they were a child. The agony of hell is there's no way out. Look, that man's going to be chewing his own tongue for 1,000,000 years, and he'll see people sitting at the marriage supper of the Lamb, drinking the wine of the ages. He has an appetite, but there's nothing to satisfy. All his life he lusted for women, and now he can't celebrate his lust. Come on now, hell is eternal. There's no escape. There's no way out. Isn't it amazing that an omnipotent God will let you smack him in the face? There's a hymn that says, depth of mercy, can there be mercy still reserved for me? Can my God his wrath forbear? Me, the chief of sinners, spare. I had long withstood his grace, long provoked him to his face, would not hearken to a call, grieved him by 1,000 falls. Isn't that your history? Be honest about it. The normal Christian life is holiness. Amen. Outside of that, it's sickness. Do you know it's killing America? Killing Christians? Creature comforts. Our beds are too comfortable. Our homes are too comfortable. You know, we're the most undisciplined generation the world's ever known. Disciple comes from the word discipline. How many of you are disciplined? How many go to bed at the same time every night, get up every morning at the same time? How do you discipline your appetites? How do you discipline your tongue? We're the most weak, effeminate Christianity the world's ever had. No, but no wonder nobody wants it. It has no strength. You know, that's a tragedy with millions of people. They'll go through life blind, blind to God, blind to God's righteousness, blind to his justice, blind to his holiness, blind to his commandments. And in a moment of time, they'll wake up in hell. What's the condition of America like spiritually tonight? Zero. Why? Because we've got blind men coming out of seminaries. The men there don't teach them. They don't hear a word about hell. They're blind themselves, and as blind men, they lead the blind, and they go to hell. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many mighty things? They said, we did it in thy name. He said, you're workers of iniquity. You did it in my name to exalt your name. I never knew you. Well then, didn't he know what they were doing? Sure, he watched every miracle they did. But he said, I never knew you in a love relationship. You were so busy with an external ministry. You were so busy running here and there. No time for God. Come on, how much time have you spent with Jesus today? When you last go to him and say, I'm not going to ask you for a thing. I've come to worship you in spirit and in truth. I remember the first time Dr. Tozer said to me, he said, you know, Brother Len, I have never heard a sermon on worship in my life. Well, I happen to be 79 years of age, and I've been going to church, to meetings for 75 years. I've never heard a message on worship. But also active in the outer court, serving the people in the outer court. We never get into the Holy of Holies. You know why we don't miss the glory of God? Because we've never seen it, that's why. We're so used to meetings. We're so used to being happy. We're used to some dumb guy getting up there, saying, let's all stand and raise your hands and worship. You don't worship God standing up. You worship God on your belly. Oh, but we stay hollow, we get excited, we give a few tracts out. It'd do a lot of us a lot more good if we stayed home on our bellies and worship and listen to God. I pitied my father, he wasn't very well educated. But after I got educated, I envied my father. So simple, so pure, so passionate, so prayerful. I never saw a preacher weep. My daddy would get down and groan and weep and travel for lost men and women. You know, there are no tears in heaven, and there are no smiles in hell. There's no sorrow in heaven, there's no joy in hell. I'll tell you who lives in hell. The fearful, the unbelievers, the abominable, the murderers, the whoremongers, the sorcerers, the liars. They all have their part in the lake which burneth with fire. You know what God's looking for? People who live recklessly for him. Not concerned about public opinion. Not even about preacher's opinion. Becoming a love slave of Jesus Christ. Again, I say, immediately he got that cross, you know that man was going out, he wasn't coming back. Immediately he got a cross, you know he had no right to his own. All his own plans have gone. I'm sick of sloppy evangelism. Lord, why should they obey you when we don't obey you? Why should they tremble before you when we don't tremble at your majesty and your holiness? The sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. They were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.